Religion and religious extremism. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين سيدنا وحبيب قلوب العالمين محمد المصطفى وعلى آله الأطهار وعلى أصحابه الأخيار. Respected religious leaders, His Excellency and other members of the diplomatic corps, my fellow peace-building practitioners and teachers, ladies and gentlemen, Salamun alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, blessings, and mercy of God be upon you all. So in this short talk, first, I would like to give a conceptual framework on radicalization and violent extremism, and then to be followed by a short discussion also on religious extremism, specifically answering the question, is religious extremism necessarily blameworthy or not? And then I would like to introduce two integrated concepts of legitimacy and acceptability, or what we call as mashru'iyya and maqbuliyya in the Arabic parlance. And then finally, I would deal with the role of religious leaders in combating religious extremism. And then after that, I will make my conclusion or concluding remarks. In any preventing or countering violent extremism trainings and workshops, usually the first session is alluded to conceptual clarification. And the first question being posed always is something like this. Is to be radical or extremist necessarily bad and therefore condemnable? Basically, we define radical to be the one that advocates fundamental and or drastic change. When we say extremist, we usually refer to someone that holds a view or displays a behavior or action different from the usual, or what we call as normal. Consciously or unconsciously, wittingly or unwittingly, whenever we say extremist, we are imagining in our mind a spectrum having two ends, which the extreme parts with its middle is what we imagine to be the normal or norm or normal as adopted by the majority, whereas the left and the rightmost are what we call as the extreme parts. George Washington was definitely a radical during the American War of Independence, because instead of maintaining America under the British Empire, he was opting for American independence. Our very own Andres Bonifacio was a certified extremist, quote unquote, because instead of just reform under Spanish sovereignty, he was fighting for separation from Spain. Nelson Mandela was a convicted, quote unquote, terrorist by the apartheid regime in South Africa. And because of this heinous crime, he was imprisoned for almost three decades. How about the Jewish young man, by the way, who had the audacity to turn upside down the money changer's table in the Temple of Solomon? He would also address his fellow Jews as "you serpents, you generation of vipers, and a wicked and adulterous generation." he must be an extremist during his time. As you see, knowing the context of such terms as radical and extremist is very, very important. Let us equally pose this fundamental question. Is religious extremism necessarily bad and thus blameworthy? How about the case of one who voluntarily makes the vow of celibacy and poverty to become a nun or priest? Accordingly, he or she makes decision as a religious calling. How about the case of a teetotaler who totally abstained from alcohol on account of religious conviction? How about the case of a non-smoker in a country or city of smokers who refrains from smoking due to a religious reason? Is their religious extremism necessarily bad? It's not, of course, because there is a missing element here, namely violent imposition or compulsion. If a would-be nun voluntarily makes a vow of celibacy and poverty, it's just okay. It will not be okay if she begins to impose celibacy upon all women by force. If a person does not drink alcohol, it's just okay. He will become questionable when he starts forcing the hook, line, and sinker of his teetotalism down the throat or teetotalism down the throat of the people around him. If they would be noun, nun and the teetotaler do so, they may be accused of violent extremism in the name of or under the guise of religion. So with this introduction, we come to the point of religious extremism. Usually in many speaking engagements that I have, especially in Mindanao, I am always asked with this line of question. We know that you graduated from Iran. How do you differentiate its Islamic Republic from the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria, or what we call as ISIS? So, to make the answer short, I first introduce them, or I just introduce them, the concept of legitimacy and acceptability, or mashru'iyya and maqbuliyya. And before that, I would mention to them, or I would tell them, that the stateness of the ISIS is actually a misnomer from the post-Westphalian understanding of the term state, because it is a transnational group backed by some global and regional powers and whose perceived territory is not just Iraq and Syria, but the entire globe, including Mindanao, which they considered the capital of what they called Wilayatul Mashriq or Eastern Province. On the other hand, the Islamic Republic of Iran is a founding member of the United Nations Organization and a longtime member of the Non-Proliferation Treaty or NPT, of which the West's darling in the Middle East has never been a member. Unlike the self-proclaimed champion of democracy and defender of human rights in the world, Iran is a country which has never invaded another country for the past 250 years. Not an inch was added to its current territory. I repeat, not an inch. And in summary of my explanation, in the Islamic Republican system, the word Islamic represents the element of legitimacy or mashru'iyya, while the word republic symbolizes the element of acceptability or maqbuliyya. And these two elements must go hand in hand, like the wings of a bird. So when we talk about religious leaders' role in combating religious extremism, actually we have no time for dismissal attitude, such as saying they are not Islamic. Because whenever, as soon as we say they are un-Islamic, they would cite tens of Quranic verses and they would cite hundreds of ahadith justifying their acts and acts of violence and terrorism. So instead of just the dismissal attitude that we do, religious leaders should deal with theology versus quote-unquote their theology. One good example of that is the open letter to Baghdadi sent by Sunni ulama around the world. In the parlance of peace building, this is what we call as counter-narrative or countering the religious extremism's narrative. So in conclusion, in the world today, where the seclusion of the so-called ascetics serves as a moral carta blanche to the bullies, while the militant extremism of the so-called Puritans victimizes the innocents, the proactive role of religious leaders, which combines religious legitimacy and people's acceptability, is definitely a recipe for moderation and rationality. And for details on the, for a detailed discussion of the concepts and other concepts that I have mentioned, you can refer to the book, The Hermeneutics of Violent Extremism in Mindanao, which is available at LZ Style Bookshop as well as in Amazon. So thank you so much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.